hunger for food, money, success, and knowledge is present everywhere. Hunger at the end leads to satisfaction. Similarly, it also leads to success. After an energetic and knowledgeable first half session, I, Dipshika Singh,
and I, Alok Rohan,
welcome you all back to the journey of Balaji Institute of Management and Human Resource Development Business Convention 2016.
Our souls are united as a corporate stalwart. Have healed our students with a comprehensive corporate idea and understanding. There's a very great aphorism that information is a pretty thin stuff unless mixed with experience and attitude.
May I request you to join your hands for a polymath or whisker, Mr. Apurva Chamaria, VP and Head Corporate Marketing HCL.
We'd like to call upon the stage Dr. G. Gopalakrishna, Director of BIMHRD, to welcome our guest with a bouquet.
Thank you, sir. May I now call upon Nirmesh Singh, Student Manager, BIMHRD, to introduce Mr. Apurva Chamaria.
Good afternoon, one and all present here. It gives me immense pleasure and honor to welcome our guest, Mr. Apurva Chamaria, who is the Vice President and Head Corporate Marketing for HCL Technologies, a $7 billion global IT major. Under his leadership, HCL became the fastest growing brand. In the last 3 years of HCL campaigns, we have won 101 prestigious global and regional marketing awards. In his 11 years at HCL, he has performed various roles, including being CEO of Vinith Nair's EA, Sales Director at HCL America during business development, and leading marketing and strategy for enterprise applications business. He has worked in various sales and marketing positions at Rand HC Laboratories, which is now in pharmaceuticals. He has also been a journalist and a client servicing executive at advertising agency. In various parts of his career, he has worked in Asia Pacific, India, Africa, UK, and North America. He holds a double master's in business management and advertising. He completed his schooling from Mayo College, Ajmer. Currently, he is pursuing his senior executive leadership program from Harvard Business School, Boston. He is regarded as a thought leader on digital transformation and is regularly quoted in publications. He is a sought-after speaker and has keynoted at Oracle Cloud World, LinkedIn Tech Connect, Microsoft Ignite, Hindustan Times Top 50 Brands, etc. He is a member of the advisory board at Mudra Institute of Communications, Ahmedabad. He is a columnist for the Pitch and Digital Market Asia magazines. His book, You Are the Key, Unlock Doors Through Social Selling, hit number 2 in Amazon India's bestsellers list with 20 days of being launched in January 2016. It was also recognized by Prime Minister Modi for contributing to Digital India. In his spare times, he likes mentoring startups and helping them scale their business. Some of the startups he is mentoring include Play or Sports, Fun Locker, Film Ballas, Sponsify Me, Checkbook, etc. Government of India recently appointed Apurva sir as an advisor to Invest India, Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. Sir, so we are deeply honored to welcome you, and now we would like to invite Mr. Apurva sir to address the gatherings.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
So, you know, speaking after lunch is usually a very, very tough act. I was just told that all of you have gone out for lunch, and you're just back from lunch. So, I'll try my best to keep you awake and not lull you to sleep. I have a presentation which has 200 slides. Very good. So at least I got a remark out of you. It's a pleasure to be here. I was here last year addressing your seniors, and some of you might have been in the audience. It's a fantastic college. I love coming here. It's very green. It's very organized, and it's very professional. So. Firstly, let's put your hands together for all of you who've been awesome today. Let me ask you a question, and I want a show of hands. How many of you want to be entrepreneurs or think you are entrepreneurs? Amazing. I already love you guys. 70% of the batch wants to be entrepreneurs or think you are already entrepreneurs. It's fantastic. This presentation is going to be very, very important to all of you who think you are entrepreneurs or want to be entrepreneurs. Today we are going to talk about how do you win. Do you guys love winning?
Yes, sir.
How do you create winning teams and how do you create companies which win? This is not only important for people who want to be entrepreneurs, but equally important for people who want to be employees. Today companies are looking at people and they're looking at employees who have what I call a founder DNA, who have enough entrepreneurship built into them. One very interesting data point is, and I was reading somewhere, I think it was in Fortune, the amount of change which the world has seen in last 3 years is more than the change which the world has seen in 30 years, last 30 years. So what do you think is changing? Anybody? Technology is bringing about a change. There are three large start a presentation, either the file doesn't open or the projector doesn't work. So I'm very experienced in this. Anyway, while they try to fix the... Okay, it's working. So, what is changing in the world is, firstly, all the information you need to find in the world is available online. And let me give you an example. Today, if you wanted to understand how 3D printing works, it will possibly take you 2 hours of search on YouTube to understand most of what is needed to start printing in a 3D format. If you wanted to learn Python programming or wanted to learn how to write code in HTML5, possibly take you 8 hours on YouTube. Everything which was sacred earlier, which was not available earlier, is available online. Second key factor is, today the phone in your pocket possibly holds more computing power than the computing power which was running National Stock Exchange 10 years ago. Right? With Reliance Jio coming up with a very, very attractive data package, data prices are going to crash even further, which means data and bandwidth is going to be ubiquitous. The third factor is price of storage is dropping drastically. Today, if you are a startup, you can talk to a company like IBM or Amazon and pretty much get $8,000 to $10,000 of storage credit free every month for the next 3 to 5 years. Why am I talking about this? The reason this is important to understand is these factors make it a brilliant time to be an entrepreneur. The cost of capital is low. The cost of technology is even lower, and the ease of setting up business has never been higher. What is really, really happening is the world is changing from an economy being driven by market share. If you go back 20 years ago, the dream companies on campuses were companies which had huge manufacturing plants, huge distribution networks, and huge number of employees. These were asset-heavy companies. Today's world is all about being asset-light and experience-centric. It's no more important to have huge amount of market share, but companies believe that if you have a huge amount of mind share, that will lead to market share. Why is this happening? What has changed? And who are the people driving the change? What is really, really changing is 10 years ago, 20 years ago, in every category you had two or three products. If you spoke about cars, you had a Fiat with a hand gear shift, you had an Ambassador, and at best you had a crummy Maruti 800. To get any of those cars when you wanted it, in the color you wanted it, you possibly needed to know someone or pay a premium. It's completely, completely changed. Today it's all about customer centricity, mass personalization, long tail product management. Today there are people possibly in your college, people sitting around you who could be interested in a genre of music which possibly has only 20 people in the world who listen to it. And you would still be able to find it online, download it, buy it, listen to it, create a fan community on Facebook. That's what has changed. Earlier, if the market was not big enough, if you did not have millions of people wanting to buy your product, you couldn't kick it off. Okay, why did they fix this? Now, who are the people who are driving this change? The people who are driving this change are people whom I call as smart creatives. Who are smart creatives? All of you, that's a very good answer. But what really differentiates smart creatives from other people? They have a very, very high degree of technology understanding. Willingness to do, yeah. They're very, very creative. So 10 years ago, people used to say that if you're in finance, you will get a higher paying job. If you're in finance, you can be the CEO. Then it became finance and marketing or sales. Today, it's actually people with a liberal arts background which are in short supply. So if you have a history honors degree, if you've done an arts graduation, if you've actually done a course in design thinking, those are the kind of people which are in short demand. Most of the business schools I go to have 60-70% of the batch is engineers. Being an MBA or being an engineer is almost like doing a BCom 10 years ago now. It's become a very, very hygiene condition. So now what gets my eye when we go to recruit is, oh, this person is not an engineer, he must have done something interesting. The best joke which I heard on engineers, and this is not to really pull your leg, is engineering is what people do, and after that they go and figure out what they want to do. So, big hand to all of you who are not engineers there. The third thing that smart creative people have... Yeah, thank you. So they have technical knowledge, they have creativity, and third thing is they have business expertise. How much ever we would like to believe that business expertise lies in reading business books, and the more books you have read, the more experience you have in business, unfortunately it doesn't work like that in the world. Business expertise only comes from running a business. It could be a small business while you're running, while you're working in college. I was at one of India's top MBA schools recruiting, and I saw a resume which had a very, very low GPA. It was absolutely low, and this is one of the top business schools in India. And just out of curiosity, I called the candidate over for an interview. The way I look at it, either you have very high GPA or you have very low. Medium is boring. And I asked the candidate, I said, what were you doing which was more important than studies? And you spent 2 years with this college. And he basically told me, he coded an online poker game, and he found the course very easy. He said, you know, MBA is very easy, I can. So I really didn't feel, I had already paid for it, so I couldn't step out. And I thought this is a great market. All educated people, all have the paying power to pay these high fees. And I created an online game and people were playing it and my fees became free. And over 2 years, everybody, 70% of the batch and possibly 100% of the professors were playing it. So I made a lot of money and that's why my GPA is low. I said, wow, that's an interesting story. And then I validated it with a few of his professors and they very sheepishly admitted that yes, they've been playing the game and it's very addictive. And we ended up hiring that guy. So, very, very important to find people who have a business acumen, who are creative and who have a deep technical knowledge. I would go to the extent of saying if you went back 20 years ago, something like typing was a core skill. And your parents would tell you, go out and learn typing. 10 years ago or 5 years ago, it became Word, PowerPoint, Excel. Today, coding is almost a base skill. If you can't do some basic level of coding, marketing has mostly become MarTech, marketing technology. You should really, really think. I've been led to believe that most of you are first or second year students. So there's still a lot of time you have to learn coding and so take out time to do that. That's my advice. Now, what is the problem with large companies today? And large companies are not defined to one sector, but these are companies which could be banks, which could be telcos, which could be manufacturing companies. The problem with most large companies is people feel information is power and information should be hoarded. Only I know this piece of information and that's my source of power. What does this do? This slows down decision making. Second thing is, the companies have been designed in such a manner where failure is very expensive. As soon as, when you join as a youngster, as a management trainee or as a summer trainee, you very quickly realize that if you have a crazy idea, people look at you weirdly and you're encouraged not to do it. The only thing you're told is, this is the reason why it will not work. These are 10 reasons why it will not work. The third thing is, decision making is completely centralized. It's very top down. Think about the words we use in management. We will use penetration strategy. Pricing, right? We will kill competition. Where does it come from? All this comes from army, which is a very traditional command and control style of management. It's very old-fashioned, it's management 101. Management today is all about creating holocratic organizations. These are organizations which believe in bureaucracy. These are companies which are self-governed, where employees don't look up to the CEO for decision-making. These are self-governed, people are accountable and empowered to take decisions. That's the next wave of organization. These organizations move much faster than large companies. It just happens that most of these organizations are startups. The problem with most large companies is they are designed to be slow. Very, very slow. They are designed to be run by committees. You know what's the best definition of a committee I've ever heard? A camel is a horse designed by a committee. Either the joke was very sophisticated or you're very sleepy. Moving slow doesn't work in an internet economy. It just doesn't work. In an internet economy, it's important to ship even if you're 80% correct. How many of you are perfectionists or you think you are perfectionists? Raise your hands. Don't be shy. We're not judging you. 10, 15, 20, 20 of you in a cloud of 800. And I can see a lot of nudges that, you know, raise your hand. And well, the bad news for the 20 of you is, in an internet economy, it's important to ship even if you're 80% right. Because by the time you are 100% right and the product is perfect, and the Word document is perfect, and all the T's are crossed, and all the I's are dotted, and all the full stops have been put, the competition would have eaten your lunch. So in an internet economy, you need to retrain yourself not to be perfect, but to be fast and to be 80% right. What works? So the first part of my session was what doesn't work. Now let's see what works. What makes people successful? What makes companies successful? And what do you need to know to win? How do you build a smart, internet-friendly 21st century culture? Now, the only way to win is to attract talent which is better than you. So whenever you are hiring people, whenever you are looking for co-founders, whenever you are looking for colleagues to work on a project, whenever you are making your study groups in Balaji, hunt around and look for people who are smarter than you. They make life much more easier. How do you do that? Not very easy to do. The good or bad part is the smart people know they are smart. They are not easy to convince. They are very smart and they can't be fooled. You can't just show them some marketing leads and attract them to your group, to your study group, to your company. You can't get them as a co-founder easily. Smart people only care about one thing. They need to really, really care about the place they work in. They need to be very passionate about the idea. They want to work with people who are fun to work with. They want to be excited. They want to feel alive every moment. They are not excited by 700-page documents or 30-page slide decks. They are excited by your ability to narrate a story, your ability to convince them about a business plan. So the first thing you should do when you're starting companies or creating groups is firstly talk about and try defining what do you care about as a group? How will you make decisions? What are your shared aspirations? What are your shared worries? Very, very important. In HR, it's known as forming, norming, storming. Sound familiar?
Yes, sir.
It's not only a concept. Very, very important to do. What this does is a core bunch of people stay together. There are shared goals, shared values. Even more important, once you've defined these, you have to live by them. They just can't be a fancy poster in your room or a fancy t-shirt you wear. You have to actually live by them. When does this get tested? A lot of you will say, you know, I'm honest, I'm punctual, I'm a dreamer, I work very hard, I'm very creative. When does it get tested? It gets tested when there is a crisis. You've set out, you've launched a company, one of the company's core values is honesty. You're running out, you only have money to pay the last 1 month's paycheck. There is a client who comes to you and your friend in the client side says, I can tell you right now, you don't have this feature in your product or service, but if you just make a claim that, you know, we are building this and we will launch it in 2 months, they will give you the business. It's a crisis. One of your core values is honesty. That is the time which tests whether it's actually your core value or it's just a clever sticker on your car. It's best to work in small teams. Amazon has this very interesting philosophy that the optimum team size is a team which can finish lunch in 2 pizzas. Right? Best teams are, at least in HCL, we practice what are called teams of 30. The reason they are the best is, if you are working in a 100 people team, nobody knows anybody, nobody cares about anybody. Anyways, it breaks down to smaller teams, silos within them. None of the silos get along well with each other and no work gets done. You know, one thing which will strike you when you go to any startup office is there are no cubicles. They have tables like these, they have people sitting all around them. And tremendously crowded. They do this because crowded places breed serendipity. They increase the flow of information. If you're staying in a hostel which doesn't have individual rooms, which has dorms of 8, like most business schools like IIMs and even Harvard and Stanford have dorms. The reason why dorms are important is there are 8 people crammed in a small space. You're daily talking to each other, you're going out for coffee, you're working. And often your dorm mates are different from the mates in your study group, which leads to a lot of serendipitous conversations. What did you guys learn in class? What happened? Whom are you hanging around with? Which results in a lot of crazy ideas and innovation. How do you organize yourself? Like one of the things which you guys are doing right now is organizing this fest. Now my experience when I was in college was, usually the fourth year kids are the guys who manage. They give all the gyan, and the first year and second year run around. This was my experience, maybe it's changed now. I'll tell you why it doesn't work. This kind of organization is organization by seniority. It is not organizing the team around impact. Because maybe there is someone in first year who knows all the sponsors and he should lead the sponsorship team. There's a fourth year kid who's telling him what to do and he's like, my idea is not being appreciated, why should I run around so much? Always organize teams around impact areas and not seniority. More years of experience really doesn't mean more years of experience, it just means you're older. Which at times is not a very good thing. Next comes strategy. You found the smart creative people, you figured out a way to hire them, you've created a culture which makes them want to join and retain. It is very important to create business plans, but it is equally important to not stick to them when situations change. Documents don't run business. Customers and competition forces you to react in ways in which you are not imagining. So if the business plan is your Holy Bible or Gita or whatever, it's not going to work. It's just a plan. And we know what happens when you're making plans. God has other plans. So you need to have the ability to pivot, drop out your assumptions, change your track. The other and more important part is smart creatives hate being told what to do. Are there people in the room who really, really hate being told what to do? Raise your hands. Wow. I feel I'm the only non-smart creative in a bunch of smart creatives. The business has to be based on a strategic insight. It can't be based on a strategic plan. The difference is your plan will change a lot, your foundation will be stable. So if you are Ola, and your insight was a large population of Indians don't own cars, but they want to have the dignity of going to a place in a car or an automobile, you started with that core foundation. The foundation has not changed. Today you are also doing autos. You're doing shared cars. Right? That's the difference between a plan and a stable foundation. Now, what does a foundation have? And what is the difference between a plan and a foundation? The first core tenet is build superior products based on deep insights. That's the only way to get product market fit. Good insights don't come from sitting in air-conditioned offices or sitting in fancy Starbucks. Good insights come when you walk around the road, when you meet people, when you do consumer research, when you talk to real users who are using alternate products or products of your competition. It's very important to know competition, but equally important not to follow competition. How many of you think being competition-centric is a good idea? Okay? Very few of you. That's a very good sign. You should not be competition-centric. You should be customer-centric. Because if you are very competition-centric, you will lose track of customer. You will end up following what the competition is doing. If the competition is an internet company giving a 50% discount, rather than focusing on improving your customer value proposition, you will follow and you will give a 60% discount. Very, very important. Never delegate hiring. Even today, when we hire for my team, I personally visit all business schools. Even if we are hiring laterals, even if it's office staff or office help, I personally interview everyone. If your whole company is going to be based and the growth is going to be based on hiring smart creatives, you can't delegate hiring. It can't be the HR manager's job, it can't be the recruiter's job. All of you personally need to be very good hires. You need to think about what are the questions you will ask. What do responses mean? What are the traits you will look at? It becomes critical to be a good hiring manager. Now that you've hired smart creatives, you need to give them a place to grow and enjoy playing. If you don't give them the freedom to run, it kills their spirit and independence. And either they quit or they stop being smart creators. It happens. How many of you have done your summers last year? Summer training internships?
This year.
When did your internships get over? I don't want company names, but did some of you feel you had great ideas and either people didn't listen to them or they didn't get implemented? Very few of them. I'm assuming others didn't have great ideas. Some of you are saying it's got implemented. Very good. We are often taught it's very important to build consensus. Do you work in groups? Do you get group assignments? How many of you think building a consensus is very important? Most of you. Well, I have bad news for you. It's a very overrated virtue. What is important is you listen to everybody. Giving everybody a patient hearing, trying to understand, is very important. It's never about agreeing with everyone. It's about finding the right answer. If there are 8 people in the team and 5 of you feel this is the right way to go, 2 of you are not saying anything, and 1 of them is convinced that all of them have got it wrong, it often makes sense to stop yourself and try to understand why is that one person so committed to his or her idea. If everybody is headed in the right direction or in the same direction, it's often the wrong direction. It's too crowded. The doorway will get jammed. So you often should encourage people in your team, in your companies, and try to get people who are dissenters, who are contrarian, who have different ideas, who will challenge you. This is different from people who will say no to everything. These are not negative people. They are people who want to do things but have a different way of looking at life. Communication is very, very important. So please spend the next 1 year, 2 years in business school, in engineering college, doing a lot of presentations. Every time you get a chance, jump on and say, I'll do the presentation. Extremely, extremely important. How many of you are in marketing? Wow. All of you? Okay, how many of you are in HR? Equal number of people. It's funny. Finance? Okay. Operations, supply chain, IT? I love the way all of you are sitting together. All HR people are here. All operations people and IT people are there. All marketers are there. Well, I again have an interesting piece of advice for you. All of you are in the business of marketing. whether you are an HR manager or an operations manager, all of you are either selling or marketing something. You might create an employee compensation plan, but if your employees don't buy into it, if it is not launched well, it will not work. Let's talk about goals. When you entered college, did you have goals? Can any of you share your goals with me? Okay, let me ask you a very, very interesting thing. Does anybody watch Suits here? What is the famous Harvey Specter line on goals? Okay. During the session, if somebody can research and tell me what is the famous Harvey Specter line on goals.
Sir?
Yes?
This is life, I want this.
Okay, that's one of his quotes, but there's a better quote. He says, I don't have objectives, I have goals. The difference between objectives and goals is objectives backed by a clear direction, time-bound approach is goals. So I'm sure a lot of you had goals when you, some of your goal must have been to get a dream job, somebody's goal must have been to get an education and a dream job. It's very important to have unreasonable, unattainable goals. The reason why this is important is at every step the world will tell you it can't be done. Today, if you were to tell somebody, I want to launch a company and raise $100 million, what would people say? Can't be done. It's brilliant, you're on the right track. What is the use of having a dream, a goal which is too small and everybody thinks you can do it? Anyways, you will do it, it's not exciting. Have goals which people laugh at. Have goals where people tell you, call you mad. Those are the right goals. Very, very important to have such goals. Whenever you're setting out your goals, use this trick to test whether the goals are large enough. There's a very famous management thinker called Andy Grove. Andy Grove was the founder of Intel. It's a large microprocessor company. And Andy Grove said, companies should believe in BHAGs, big, hairy, audacious ideas, goals. We've changed it in HCL, we call it BHAIs, bhais. Big, hairy, audacious ideas. We don't want to bhag, we don't want to run. We want to be the big daddy. Who are the people you should listen to? Are these your family? Yes, you should listen to your family. I'll not advise you not to listen. Yes, it should be your boyfriends and girlfriends. But when you... Okay. I hear the guy saying no. Never, okay. I see a lot of heartburn there. But in companies, in project teams, when you're trying to build something, listen to the people who are closest to the ground. These are not people who are accountants. It's usually not your CEO. Listen to people who are actually working with customers, who are building products. Listen to the people in suits and not the people who are wearing ties and coats. At least for me, my warning sign goes off if I see somebody in a tie. When somebody is already working, and I can understand you're wearing a tie because you want a job or there's an interview. Doers are usually too busy to be doing to be wearing a suit and a tie. In none of the startups and none of the internet companies, you will find people in suits. They're too busy doing. And it's become perfectly acceptable. The new dress code is actually denims and a casual shirt. That's the new suit. Ideas can come from anywhere. Do you really believe that there are people who have no ideas? Do you believe that everybody, all of you have ideas?
Yes, sir.
So please practice what I call active listening. Most of you hear but don't listen. Do you know what is the difference between listening and hearing?
Yes, sir.
Very good. I can tell you, when I was in college, I didn't know. So you're already way ahead of me. So all you need is a big idea. Ask yourself, what could be true in 5 years? I'll give you a simple example. 10 years ago, the biggest business for any courier company was shipping documents. Mark sheets, property papers. In 10 years, that business totally collapsed. What happened? Everything became a PDF or an email. The action moved to shipping internet packages. You order from Amazon and you get a shipment. All the courier companies moved to shipping. What is going to be the next wave of disruption? Yes? Any thoughts on what will make drones redundant? 3D printing. Thank you. Great answer. People will soon just buy, and in your email you will get code and you will print it out. Why would you need package delivery? So really, really ask yourself, what is going to be true 5 years from now? Not what is the market opportunity now. Whatever is the market opportunity now, there are already 30, 40, 100 companies attacking it. And you will be the 301st company to attack it. Which means you will be fighting for the same quality of talent, you will need more money. Attack something which is a little more far out. The last words I want to leave you with is, try to imagine the unimaginable, because a lot of unimaginable is happening right now. Thank you. That's a great question. But can we stick to questions around the topic? I want to make sure that you're getting enough out of this session. So until unless you are a shareholder and it's a genuine interest, I can explain it later. But let's stick to questions around the topic. It will help you more. Thank you. Any questions on marketing, on building businesses?
Hello. Afternoon, sir. Hello, sir. Sir.
Hi.
I'm from Apurva Marketing. I just wanted to ask one question.
I'll teach you a trick. When speaking in the microphone, hold it like this. Keep it far. If the microphone is very close, can you see the difference? Yeah.
Sir, I just wanted to ask one question, sir. You said dream should be one thing that it shouldn't be attainable. It should be quite big. So there are two contradictory statements. I've heard someone saying that dreams should be achievable. It should be something which is real. So don't you think that these are two contradictory statements? What's your take on this?
These are not two contradictory statements. These are statements from two different people. There's a difference.
So what's your take on this?
My take is, there are people who are reasonable, and reasonable people only make reasonable progress. It is upon you, do you want to make reasonable progress or do you want to make unreasonable progress? You really cannot make unreasonable progress by being reasonable and having unattainable dreams. Different kind of people. I am very unreasonable, so for me a reasonable dream doesn't work. Thank you.
Hello. Sir, I am Arjun from Senior Operations JMO. So
So regarding perfectionist, you are telling that you have to, at this point of time, you have to, even if you attain 80% of any product or service, you have to sell it, sell the competition will take it out. But if you see the example, who made it for 80% they sold it. Recent example being Note 7, Galaxy Note 7, which they did capture the good market share of iPhone 7 and 7S, but they failed it because of the battery problem, because it was not perfect. Second, Toyota Innova and the Toyota's, those products. It was not complete, they sold it, showed that they have a huge and they're having the highest market share regarding cars. But they are still not perfect and they are now back with $16 billion to reform everything because of the emission problem.
Great question, thank you for asking. The way you should look at it is, there are two schools of thought. One is waterfall, and those of you who have done software engineering will understand it. Waterfall is a very linear development methodology. Waterfall aims at perfection. The second is agile. Every day you're dropping code, you're improving the product. When I say when you are imperfect, ship it. It is because while you work at perfection, the market is changing. The customer's needs are changing. By the time you ship the product which you think is perfect, the market would have changed. So it makes more sense to ship it and continuously improve it rather than wait for the perfect product. Because there is nothing called the perfect product. Think about yourself. How many of you have used Uber or use Uber right now? Most of you? When Uber first came to India, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago. When you first saw the Uber UI, it was brilliant and you loved it. You said, it just shows me where the cab is coming from. It is what you called a wow experience. Today, every app company, whether it's a pizza delivery app, or it is a cab app, has that. Whatever you call as a perfect product today will be an inferior product tomorrow. Specifically on Samsung, products fail because of a variety of decisions, a variety of reasons. I don't know much about Innova. But at times products fail because the companies were not agile and they did not keep reinventing the product. Apple went through the same issues. Even now, Apple battery life is possibly not that great. Android is better. A lot of us still use Apple. It's not a perfect product. In fact, in every way, it's more inferior than Android. So perfection is not really required. That's my 2 cents. The other thing you should think about is practice does not make you perfect. If you're doing something wrong, practice will only make you perfect in doing a wrong thing. So all these are often statements which need to be understood a little more. Thank you.
Hello. Hello, sir. Myself, Jikal Modi, and I'm a BIMHRD marketing student. So my question is, we have to face the across many problems like funding and all. So how we ensure for our survival in the market?
You're asking me to give you the secret of life. So firstly, I'll tell you, if you're seeing it as a problem, startup is not the game for you. Because as you scale, there will always be funding challenges, there will always be employee challenges, there will always be competition challenges. That's a part of running your own company. I would say network heavily. A tip. Across 2 days, possibly 3 days, you will have 20 speakers listening in. Network heavily. I'm not going to give you more tips, but you know what I'm talking about. So network heavily, raising capital is not that hard.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
So my question is, what are as we talk about funding and all, so I want to ask, there's a general phenomena that only IITians, IIMs get the funding from angel funders. Whereas, if at all somebody from a mid-level management school want to start up, so they struggle for incubators. So like this is something the idea is it is identified on the way of your degree, where it is from. I'm sorry, but
I don't agree with that statement. Most startups, when they're applying to an incubator, there could be possibly some incubators which are looking at your degrees, but degrees are the, I've either mentored or invested in 19 startups till now. Other than possibly two which have an engineering degree from IIT, none of them are IITians, none of them are from IIMs. It really doesn't matter. You show me a healthy balance sheet, you show me traction, you show me a product which is getting great product market fit. Really doesn't matter because your degree is not what will get me returns. I can't show you degree and the customer will buy your product, right?
The trend shows that only for people from mid-level management struggle for incubators as well.
Did it ever strike you that maybe people from other colleges don't apply that much?
Yeah.
I can use statistics.
Whatever I saw being in a group of startups and whatever I saw like 2 years ago,
I'll give you advice. I think you can use data to prove anything. Reports and research reports and statistics are only statistics. The way you should personally think of it is, you are the exception. If you are going to be the norm, then it's going to be very challenging. You shouldn't care whether the funding is only going to IITs or not. There are always exceptions to make it. Don't be bothered about these reports and people have to write something, so they will write. I know tons of exceptions who are getting funding or doing very well. And there could be many reasons. Maybe the number of people who are IITians and are at that level and apply and want to do startups is much higher. Maybe because their security cushion is higher and they know that if they fail, they can always get a job. I don't know what is the reason. But there are exceptions, so it's very easy. It's not that difficult. If you need any help, you can always reach out to me on Twitter or LinkedIn and I can give you some advice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, this is Rishabh Bhagwani from BIMHRD PMHRD. Sir, I have a question. You told about smart creative. So, if you have a dream to create a company that is out of box seeing the automation taking place, so what do you think that how should a person progress towards it?
Can you repeat your question? Is your question on how can you use automation on smart grids?
No, how can a person, the company who is much of a human resource required, so after 5 years there will be a lot of automation taking place.
Yeah, so that's, thank you, that's a very nuanced question. It's a very interesting question, so thank you for asking. So the gentleman's question is, will automation replace and reduce a lot of jobs? What does it mean for people like you and me? Yes, it will reduce jobs, but I don't think it will really, really hamper us. Automation is going to be a huge, huge blessing because everything which is routine, everything which is mundane will get automated. There's going to be a lot of machine learning based stuff. There's going to be a lot of cognitive computing. And think about yourself. There's a lot of stuff which you do. Is there any value in taking a car to servicing? Does anybody enjoy taking a car to servicing? That's not the kind of time you want to spend in a day. If there is a programmable button where you just hit the button and the car drives itself, and there's a very famous paper on cars that will own themselves, which means they will come out of a factory, you will not buy them, I will not buy them. The cars will buy themselves on a loan, will drive themselves. The money they collect will be used to pay the loan off. They will go for servicing. And finally, after their shelf life, they will go to a retraction center and get recycled. You can just search cars that will own themselves. It's brilliant. Do you really want to be in the business of owning cars and maintaining them? Maybe not. So there are two ways to look at. You can either see automation as a threat, or you can see it as a greatest friend, which will really help you become more productive, more useful, and focus on higher value-added activities. In fact, in software, there's going to be a lot of automation. It's already happening. A simple thing like password reset. Right now, when you call a help desk, somebody, a human picks up. We are already in HCL doing it. We have a bot called Lucy, which automatically resets your password by verifying your employee ID. And so there's a lot of automation which is already happening. Thank you. I think we don't have time for any other further questions. Thank you. You've been a great audience. God bless you.
I'm sure this session will enlighten our path for success, and it will help us in nurturing our future. Aspiring upcoming entrepreneur in this room will definitely gonna be benefited and will make the best of both the worlds in future. Shri Balaji Society, look forward for your many more sessions in future, sir. Thank you so much.
May I now request Professor D.S. Kadam, Director of Projects and Alumni Affairs, to present a token of love to our guest.